हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, इन द सीरीज ऑफ ऑनलाइन क्लास आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द गुड मॉरो बाय जॉन डन टुडे। द गुड मॉरो रिकॉर्ड्स द पैशनेट एंड डीप लव ऑफ जॉन डन। Dunn is wholly unconventional in his theme and expression. His independent spirit refused to submit to Petrarchan convention and Platonic idealism. His love poetry is fresh and original. He goes deep into his hurt and dissects his own Elizabethan feelings. Dunn's revolt against the sweetness and harmony of verse is illustrated by the ruggedness and dissonance of his lines. He went to the colloquial, to that which was nearest to the speech of men, for revealing his feelings, and yet he did not abandon his Elizabethan conceit. The good morrow, meaning good morning, is a common salutation of wish, particularly done in morning time. But here it refers to the awakening of souls in love. It is a spiritual awakening, as the poet awakens to the all-absorbing nature of his love. Now, come to the text. Please pay attention or see your book. I am going to read it out for you, the very first stanza. I wonder by my troth, what thou and I did till we lauded, were we not wind till then, but sucked on country pleasures childishly, or snorted we in the seven sleepers den? 'Tis was so, but this all pleasures fancies be. If ever any beauty I did see, which I desired and got, 'tis but a dream of thee. So in the very first stanza, John Donne describes or opens the poem in an abrupt, colloquial manner with the expression of wonder as to what the poet and his beloved did before they actually fell in love with each other. He thinks that their former pleasures and enjoyments were childish. Here Dunn alludes to the seven Christian young men who, because of the fear of persecution, took refuge in a cavern where they fell asleep and woke up 2 centuries later. Likewise, all their previous pleasures were not real and only fanciful. Earlier he desired for other beautiful women whom he loved and whose love he could get, now seemed to him as visions of the present beloved. So, in the very first a stanza. The poet means to say that he was actually dreaming before he actually fell in love. His former pleasures were just visions of what he has achieved after falling in love with his present beloved. Now, I come to the second stanza of the poem. See the text. And now, good morrow to our waking souls, which watch not one another out of fear, for love, all love of other sights controls and makes one little room and everywhere. Let the discoverers to new worlds have gone. Let maps to others worlds on worlds have shown. Let us possess our world. Each hath one and each one. So here, in the second stanza, the poet wishes good morning to their awakened souls in the second paragraph. The souls of the lovers have awakened to a new day and to a new life from a long sleep devoid of love. Their souls now pay attention to only each other without any kind of fear. Their emotion of love is powerful enough to control and channelize their perception to observe nothing except their own. Love transforms a room into a complete world by focusing the lover's attention on each other. The persons involved in new discoveries may go on search for new lands, and map readers may chart new areas, but they cannot find a world more wonderful than theirs, as there is no other world of love than theirs. Each of the lovers has a separate world of his or her own, and when these two merge into one. Now, the last stanza or the third stanza. Please pay attention. My face is thine, I thine in my thine in mine appears, and true plain hearts do in the passage rest. Where can we find two better hemispheres without sharp north, without declining west? Whatever dies was not mixed equally. If our two loves be one, or thou and I love so alike, then none dread do slacken, none can die. The third stanza focuses on the unification of the two personalities into one. The depth of the love of the poet is so intense that he finds his image in her eyes and vice versa. In fact, their hearts are reflected in each other's face. Clearly, their faces are the mirrors of their love for each other. Dunn tries to exploit geographical facts to prove his deep love. The northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere, with polarization and declination, make one complete world. Similarly, the faces of the poet and his beloved make a complete globe even without polarization and declination. John Donne here alludes to the scholastic philosophy of St. Thomas Aquinas that the things compounded of elements between which there is no contrariety are not subject to corruption and decay. The poet feels that unequal compounds are responsible for death and destruction. But the poet's love for his beloved and vice versa neither can die, as they are made up of equal compounds. So throughout the poem, we find that Donne is giving logic after logic to prove the intensity of their love. The use of images like the seven sleepers' den, everyday life, sect on the country pleasures, one little room and everywhere, sea discoveries, hemispheres, etc. makes the poem a scholarly and witty, complex and philosophical. Thank you.